They are beautiful.
Hey, art family. Today I took my kids to the zoo and I got in a little sketching while I was there, and I decided to do a video on the great but very difficult practice of drawing animals from life. The challenge comes up a lot in the plein air painting workshops that I've taught, of just how to hit the moving target that is animals. Before I get started, I wanted to give a few tips on just lighting and things to keep in mind, but if you want to just see the demo, that's about 3 minutes and 20 in if you want to skip forward. I'd say the biggest key is to break things down in the most simplest shapes you can possible, and just lower your expectations for what you're going to get. Remember that if you're outside, we have two big light sources, the sun, warm light coming from one side, and the blue atmosphere light coming from the other direction. The sunlight's going to bounce off the ground and reflect, so all of your lower facing planes are going to be warm and have a glow to them, and all of the sides facing the sky are going to be lit up by soft blue light. Facing away from the sun, we're going to have a shadow that will be tinted blue as it faces the sky. The shadow on the ground is also going to be blue as it gets away because it's lit up by that blue light. And we always want to shift our colors from cool to warm, gently. In the background here, I'm using the darker shape of ultramarine and burnt sienna to negative paint, or to adjust the drawing and to also give depth to the image. It's also a good chance to produce some rim light on the object. You also remember, when the light bounces off of an object, it will shoot that color it picks up into another object. So in this case, if this is grass, the sunlight's going to hit it and it's going to bounce green light into the underfacing planes of an object. Remember, the furthest away is not the darkest point, because you have a terminator that is the darkest point in the shadow. Except for this part, the occlusion shadow, where light can't touch. It's the darkest point. So our goal is to apply these laws that I just talked about to an object of a local color. So the local color is whatever the inherent color of that object. So the red dot shows a red object. So we would then take these laws and apply them to that red dot. So here's a quick demo. I just wanted to show applying those laws. So I did a very quick, simple drawing of two rhinos in a muddy area. I'm putting in a dark background with burnt sienna and ultramarine just to set the tone for the image. Now I'm putting in a glowy sort of warm light on the bottom facing planes, and then a cobalt bluey light blue on the shadow side facing away from the light. My goal is to paint this object as if it's something I've never seen before in my life and I don't know what it is. It's just a group of shapes, and try to treat it as such. Just very simple shapes, and then apply those laws of light to them. Because the animal's going to move. These animals, they left at this point. They were gone. So all I have is my simple drawing and the rules of light that I know, and I can peek over at them and see their local color. One of the keys to animal drawing is just to be patient, really patient. This tiger was pacing around back and forth for a while, and I watched and I waited, and eventually he went to a shady spot and laid down for a while. He moved 5 minutes later, but it was still long enough to get in a little 20-minute sketch. And my goal isn't to produce a photograph of this tiger or to nail every single stripe. I just want to learn every lesson I can about the color and the light and what it's producing and what the simple shapes are, how the masses are built, and how they look in space. That way I can reproduce that in my personal work. I guess if I have any goal in producing an image or a sketch, it's just to give the viewer a feeling that they're there. You're not going to count every stripe and you're not going to notice every tiny little detail, but you can feel the object or the animal is there, and that's the feeling I want to produce with this sketch. So I'm using cobalt blue and raw sienna because there's trees behind the tiger, and I'm going to just create a sort of shifting warm to cool tone behind the tiger, just to set the tone for the drawing. I can only do so many layers before it gets really kind of gunky, but I'm going to use negative drawing to adjust the drawing. You can't tell right now, but later on you'll notice that I made the nose way too long, so later on we'll be using negative painting to sort of chisel out the shape of the tiger. It was sitting in the grass, so I used cadmium medium yellow medium in the mix to get that really bright glow on the grass. So we mostly know that the tiger is orange, of course, but what I want to make sure I'm doing is shifting that orange to be a little bit warmer as it gets closer to the light and a little bit duller as it goes away from the light. I do that by picking up the kind of mud of previous mixes around the palette or adding yellow ochre, because I want it to be a little bit more saturated as it gets closer to the light. So the underside of the tiger is white. So, of course, it's not going to be white of the paper. That would be tempting to do, but I'm noticing within the white, and you notice this on white houses too, there's all these subtle variations of color. So I'm going to try to pick up a lot of those blues that it's picking up, but also a lot of those greens that are being bounced and shot up into it, and also yellow ochre colors. Just these tiny, subtle changes in the color as it turns the form. I'm going to block in the kind of occlusion on the bottom of the tiger because I can see he's starting to get ready to move again. In fact, he did. He got up and started pacing around and looking at the monkeys and stuff. And I was lucky that he went back and laid back down on the ground. Although he's in a different shape, he managed to turn his head and watch the monkeys again. So luckily I was able to kind of mass in the body and the middle section enough that I could work on the head, because I really struggled with the head on the tiger. For some reason, they're really difficult. I'm trying to get in the dappled light and just observe what the light is doing and how it's affecting the tiger. One of the main things you need to do when you're sketching animals is, I mean, if you're planning on painting, that is, instead of just using pencil, is to learn to draw with the paint. It's a really helpful skill to just get past the hurdle of being nervous about putting paint down. You really have to jam into those pans and pull out some thick color and really push it around and learn how to make mistakes and not care that much or fix them and just go with it. That's kind of all you can do. One of the things that the tiger did is he had his mouth open, so I spent half the sketch trying to figure out how to get the mouth to look like it was open, and then he closed it, which was a little bit more simple, so I ended up kind of fudging the face and then changing that later on. So here I'm trying to use the stripes, the ears, to triangulate where the eye is, and I kind of got that sort of figured out, but I'm noticing that it's wrong. And it's taking me a second to realize that my error was that the nose is way too big. In fact, looking at it now, it looks like a weird dog. But at this point, I'm just trying to triangulate shapes and draw the form by using some stripes, not to draw the stripes, but just to use the stripes to feel the form of the tiger. One of the things that was kind of taking my breath away looking at this regal tiger was just the strong rim light on the back of the tiger. It was really beautiful. And so I decided I needed to darken the background a little bit more just to punch that rim light around the outside of the tiger. Again, I'm trying to feel the form of the tiger and sort of move around and make corrections where I need to make corrections. That's one of your biggest skills, is learning how to make corrections and work with a painting. If, for example, some of the skills you need to learn are using a thirsty brush, so getting just a water brush and using that to scrub away paint that you've already put down or to move stuff. I feel like people think watercolor is a very unforgiving and difficult medium. I hear that a lot from people, but really I find it very versatile because I can erase most of the problems I have, and a lot of times when you do make a mistake, people don't really notice it. Usually it's kind of it's the grand picture, it's the whole picture. If you can get all of your shapes and value working, people aren't going to notice a little burn here or there. That's not what they notice. The goal is to get them to feel the painting more than just sort of notice the little, you know, places where you dropped your paintbrush and made a dark spot in the middle or whatever. So I've kind of made the rounds around the tiger, and then I've sort of muscled up enough courage to get back into that head and try to figure out what I was doing wrong. I like to just block little forms and little shapes that I notice, and it was when I kind of tapped the nose to sort of try to get a slight shift of color as it turned that I noticed that it was a little bit too long and I need to figure something out with the face. So this is that wet brush technique I was talking about. It's just using a wet brush or a thirsty brush. Wet brush being just clean water put down that loosens up the paint. Thirsty brush being a totally dried brush that you can set on wet paint and it will absorb that color. So you can sort of rub color away that way. So I decided to just sort of go with it and smear in some color. The face was mostly in shadow, and just sort of push it, try to form it or sculpt it into shape if I couldn't quite get it right. And because one thing I know is I can totally kind of mess that color up, because I know I'm going to come back with white gouache that I put out on the pan so that I can punch back in some whites or add body to another color. You can see paint on my hand. I got paint everywhere because I forgot paper towels or my rag that I usually bring. So I ended up using my pants leg, and I had white stripes all over my side all day long. This is kind of the scariest and also the most alive I feel when I'm painting, is when a painting or a sketch dips into this sort of chaos where right now this poor tiger has no face, or whatever you're working on dips into this kind of explosion of chaos, and you can kind of wrestle with it and then sort of, you know, pull it into form, or search and then finally find, you know, the puzzle piece that clicks, that makes that form work. For this one, I resolved that the problem was in the silhouette of the mouth of the tiger, so I decided to go with one more layer of negative painting to put in the background and chisel out the form of the head of the tiger, and also chisel out the rim light on the tiger as well. I'm using negative painting with a darker color to go around the outside of the tiger, because I really want to punch the silhouette shape, and I also want to make the rim light on the tiger stand out really well. The trouble with negative painting is if you keep going with the negative painting and you keep trying to go darker and darker, it can sort of get away from you. So if you keep going with it, it'll start getting muddy and start losing its impact, and you can get just sort of a muddy picture that doesn't have a lot of color character. So you want to be careful to use negative painting to correct the drawing or to punch the light, but if you keep hammering it, you can really mess up your character of color that you have in your picture. Your best bet is to either go really strong with the color right away for a dark impact, or try to use minimal layers. One thing I noticed is that I didn't quite get the strength of saturation that I wanted where the sunlight is hitting the ground, so I'm adding some white gouache to give body to cadmium yellow to get some warmth into the light as that orange turns towards the light to punch the back of the tiger, and then also doing the same for the grass where the light is dappled from the trees above. So that's going to be it for this demo and talk. I hope you found some helpful information in it, or at least some inspiration to get out and go sketch some live animals. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments section, or you can find me on social stuff. And in the meantime, good luck and happy sketching.